Welcome. Thanks for coming. It's my fault that this is going to be in English, so I apologize. I'm American. I'm learning Norwegian, but I think you'd appreciate it if I don't try to butcher the language. Thanks for coming. It's great to have everybody here. I'm an associate professor of American literature in ELOS here at the university, and very happy to have the opportunity to talk with Jan, who, as some of you might know, is a professor of special needs education here, has published very widely in disability studies and teaches courses here as well. So what we thought we would do today is talk a bit about some representations that we get in the media, cultural events, things happening today related to disability, and maybe talk about some more problematic or provocative kinds of ideas related to thinking about disability as it's represented. And so, should we start with the Stella Young, or do you want to say
well,
something?
Well, I should probably say also that Mike is running a research group on illness and representation. And so it's, I think, rejuvenating that field here at the University of Oslo. And so maybe we'll get to talk a little bit about the intersection between disability and illness, because we come from, let's say, different sides of the table here. And we'll see if we can find some intersectionality opportunities. Mm. But yeah, let's go ahead with the clip.
Yeah, so we thought we would start with this kind of provocative idea that some people have referred to as inspiration porn. And so what we're going to show is a clip from a woman named Stella Young. Just a brief explanation of what that might be, and then we'll talk further about it.
That's when it dawned on me. This kid had only ever experienced disabled people as objects of inspiration. We are not, you know, to this kid, and it's not his fault. I mean, that's true for many of us. You know, for lots of us, disabled people are not our teachers or our doctors or our manicurists. We're not real people. We are there to inspire. And in fact, you know, I'm sitting on this stage looking like I do in this wheelchair, and you are probably kind of expecting me to inspire you, right? Yeah. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I'm afraid I'm going to disappoint you dramatically. I'm not here to inspire you. I'm here to tell you that we have been lied to about disability. Yeah, we've been sold the lie that disability is a bad thing. Capital B, capital T. It's a bad thing. And to live with disability makes you exceptional. It's not a bad thing. And it doesn't make you exceptional. And in the past few years, we've been able to propagate this lie even further via social media. You know, you may have seen images like this one, "The only disability in life is a bad attitude." Hmm. Or this one, "Your excuse is invalid." Indeed. Or this one, "Before you quit, try." Yeah. These are just a couple of examples, but there are a lot of these images out there. You know, you might have seen the one, the little girl with no hands drawing a picture with a pencil held in her mouth. You might have seen a child running on carbon fibre prosthetic legs. And these images, you know, there are lots of them out there. They are what we call inspiration porn. And I use the term porn deliberately because they objectify one group of people for the benefit of another group of people. So in this case, we're objectifying disabled people for the benefit of non-disabled people. The purpose of these images is to inspire you, to motivate you, so that we can look at them and think, well, however bad my life is, it could be worse. I could be that person. But what if you are that person? I've lost count of the number of times that I've been approached by strangers wanting to tell me that they think I'm brave or inspirational. And this was long before my work had any kind of public profile. they were just kind of congratulating me for managing to get up in the morning and remember my own name. And it is objectifying. These images objectify disabled people for the benefit of non-disabled people. You know, they are there so that you can look at them and think that things aren't so bad for you, to put your worries into perspective.
Okay, so are all of you familiar with this term, inspiration porn? It's meant to sort of provoke. What do you think about this idea, and what are maybe some of the key elements of it?
Yeah, it's a good question, because probably the idea is better than the term, in a sense, but it's certainly an idea and a phenomenon that needs a name of some sort. So we can probably circle back to the notion of whether porn is a good, whether it's a misnomer or whether we should find a different term, but there's definitely something going on with the inspirational imagery. Mm. And I think we've seen a lot of this over the last few years. We've seen the examples that Stella Young used herself, obviously, in sort of inspirational posters, memes, really, inspirational poster is a digital genre in and of itself. But of course, we've also seen the same kind of imagery in other contexts. So the Paralympics would be one very visible case where disabled people are displayed as in impressive imagery, in dramatic imagery, and certainly in inspirational imagery. And of course, in Norway specifically, we know we've had the TV series Beyond Boundaries, Ingen Grenser, which trades in much of the same imagery. And I think that one of the salient ideas here, I mean, Stella Young talks about the inspirational function, but we could also talk about the content in the images, which has a lot to do with physicality and with visual representation, which is, I think, where we could maybe try and find reasons for and against the use of porn, because there's a very high degree of physicality in these images. Mm-hmm. Disability is signified and displayed via the body, via the visible body, in particular ways. So I'd love to hear your reactions to that, whether sort of the physical aspect of this is interesting.
Mm. Yes, definitely the physical aspect, and the we've talked before a bit as well as the how these images often use more visible impairments or disabilities rather than ones that are harder to immediately see. I'm personally a little less comfortable with the use of the word porn in this formulation, and it comes from, you know, my background is literary and cultural studies, including feminist theory, and thinking about concepts like the gaze and whether whether we are always participating in kind of objectifying someone when we're talking about porn, or are there ways to complicate that? And so I think in feminist studies, for example, we might say that there are different ways of responding to something that is produced as porn. The framework might be objectifying, but there might be different kinds of viewers in the audience. But what about that? What about this? The importance of who's looking at these images?
Yeah. I don't necessarily agree completely with Stella Young that these are images that are meant to be shown to non-disabled people as a way to represent disabled people. They could just as well be directed at disabled people as a way of providing norms for how to be a disabled person. So I think there are two kinds of audiences here. Mm. But I think the overall point is that what she's pointing out is that we're at a historical moment where certain representations of disability are more visually available than they've ever been. the historian Paul Longmore pointed out some years ago that the history of disability has been an invisible history for a very long time. That disabled people have been present but invisible in the sense that they haven't been represented as disabled people. So that has changed. We're now at a point where disability is represented in particular ways, and so it would be interesting to examine what those ways are and what they signify. Mm. What do you think? Who is the audience for these images?
Well, I do think it's important to think about how these images can be viewed or read or consumed in a sense by different groups, and that it doesn't necessarily always play the same way. I think what's another issue here is I think as you're suggesting that if we're in a moment where we seemingly have more visibility of people with disabilities and seemingly positive representations, one question might be, hey, if it's hard to get any images up, why, just to kind of play devil's advocate here a little bit, why is it so bad to want to be inspired by an image of someone in a wheelchair, for example?
Yeah.
What would you say to that?
No, I would say it's not necessarily a bad thing in and of itself. But I do hope that we're in a transitional moment where these images will be contextualized to an extent that they really currently aren't. I mean, we have some other examples on the slides. I think that this might be a good time to pull up the photoshopped images from the recent Paralympics, where you have ostensibly disabled athletes or athletes with impairments that are in fact non-disabled athletes who've been photoshopped in particular ways. And these images are used to advertise the Paralympic games, which I think is interesting because it points out that representations of disability currently have some sort of symbolic value in and of themselves and completely divorced from the actual lives of disabled people. And I think that that's sort of where the most interesting opportunities for critique lies, in the disjunction between the imagery of, well, and we're done.
Sorry.
So where were the controls for this?
Is that this? Help, please. I got tired. Yeah, so hopefully we can get this back up. But I think I think what you're getting at in a sense is that there is this sort of instant symbol, that it has nothing to do with the individual people, right? That it's you see a wheelchair, you see a prosthetic limb, and that's all you need to know. We don't care at all about who that particular person is, and we don't pay attention to the societal structural obstacles that make it difficult to deal with having an impairment or disability. Instead, we get, you know, it's just willpower, right?
Yeah.
And so it's impressive if you get out of bed and remember your own name, as Stella Young suggested.
There's a strange ambiguity there, because on one level you're inspirational simply by virtue of getting up in the morning. That's her point in a sense. But at the same time, the imagery she shows is of people doing actually, objectively speaking, impressive things. I mean, the Paralympic athletes are very good at what they do, and they perform impressive physical feats. So there, in that sense, there may be two ways to interpret inspiration, either by thoroughly impressive physical achievement or by what's really no achievement at all, in a sense. Mm. But in both senses, it points away from the social world and towards willpower.
Yeah.
So I think that you make an excellent point there. I wonder if I could just make a secondary point, because I think the other part of the symbolic dimension here is that these images are also, in a sense, reductive of what disability is. I've talked about this in different contexts, that the wheelchair symbol is a very useful and very problematic signifier of disability, because the majority of disabled people do not use wheelchairs. I don't even use a wheelchair all of the time, which creates an interesting negotiation whenever I use an accessible restroom, which is obviously signified by a wheelchair. So should I bring my wheelchair into the bathroom or not? There's always a negotiation there. If you see somebody using an accessible restroom who is not in a wheelchair, are they allowed to do so? And I think that this kind of imagery represents, generally speaking, reductive mechanisms. They seek to simplify disability in one way or another.
Mm. And I was going to say, I think we could look at this this short film that was made about the Paralympics.
Yeah.
And this distinction between sort of everyday activities,
yeah,
going to the restroom, brushing your teeth, etc., and then what some of these athletes are doing, as well as musicians and things. Let's take a look at this clip, and then we can talk further.
Yes, I can, suddenly, yes, I can. Gee, I'm afraid to go on as turned into. Yes, I can. Take a look, what do you see? 133 pounds of confidence in me. Got the feeling I can do anything. Yes, I can. Something that sings in my blood is telling me. Yes, I can. I was just born today, I can go all the way, yeah, I can. Yes, 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 I can.
Hey, yes, I can.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can!
Are you ready? I can climb Everest. Yes, I can. I can fight here all night and never rest. Yes, I can. I was just born today. I can go all the way. Yes,
so, what strikes you there?
Well, why superhumans? That's the first thing. Mm. What do you think?
Yeah, it's interesting. This I'm seeing this video now making the rounds of Facebook, and people like completely inspired by it.
Yeah.
And I think it's actually a great example of what we've been talking about in Stella Young.
Yeah,
there's a couple things. The thing that immediately jumps out as more problematic. There's several things, but is the juxtaposition of just the everyday things, right? Where it's brushing your teeth, and that's somehow on the same level as somebody who has presumably worked really hard to become a really impressive musician or athlete or so and so on. But I don't know, is that one of the pieces that's most problematic for you, or what else do you see?
It certainly brings up a lot of the stuff we're talking about. There've also been a number of, let's say, less charitable response videos showing people trying to navigate the more mundane built environment and being told, no, you can't buy, you know, tall curbs and steps right. into buildings and so on. So it's been inspiring, but it's also been provocative among disability activists in the UK, certainly, who are currently being told, no, you can't buy their own government every week. But I think that we're onto something important with the juxtaposition of, let's say, trivial achievement with genuinely impressive achievement. That also brings us to the matter of superhumans. Because the implication that someone is more than human usually brings it with it the subtext that they're possibly less than human. Would you agree with that?
Mm.
I mean, we have at least one monster researcher in the audience, and there's something in the way that positive representations of disability tends to pull further away from the norm of humanity rather than towards the normate, the normal, which is interesting to me because that points out some sort of underlying unease here.
Mm. And I want to get to some superhero examples we have here, but I want to ask you a little more about this tension between sort of unrealistic expectations, right? That the answer is to just try harder, right?
Yeah.
And Stella Young has another bit where she says, you know, no staircase has ever turned into a ramp by looking at it and saying, you know, positive thinking, yes, I can. It's still going to be a staircase, right? And so I think there's the idea of it's unrealistic. First of all, there are these structural obstacles, societal obstacles. Then there's this sort of expectation that your job, if you have an impairment or disability, is to try really hard.
Yeah.
And then we have the examples. You're only impressive if you are in the Paralympics or something. And it's simply not realistic for, you know, 99% of us.
Yeah.
But the flip side of it is I will admit that there is something that is compelling to me that if we make enough sort of qualifications and say, no, this isn't the answer, willpower doesn't solve everything, we have to look at structural problems, there is something to me about, you know, trying really hard and being inspired by other people who try hard in order to achieve things. But I think it's that piece of it, which has the potential to be positive for all kinds of people, I think can get sort of lost in all the other problems.
Yeah.
But what do you think about that tension between, like, you know, why can't we, or under what conditions would it be okay for some of this to be inspirational?
Yeah.
Versus unrealistic expectations and so on and so forth.
Yeah, I think that's the unresolvable issue here, because I don't think that there have been many. Let's put it this way. It's very hard to make interesting films about structural barriers. It's very hard to make heroic films about the welfare state. We are sort of, we're up against the conventions of narrative here. And so it's very hard to envision the kind of story that we may be looking for told well. I mean, most of narrative as we know it, and certainly sort of narrative in the grand Western tradition tends to focus on individual achievement rather than on structures and complex dynamics.
Mm.
So I think we may be in the unenviable position of always trying to bring forward a form of critique rather than trying to genuinely develop counter-narratives from scratch.
Mm.
Because it's always a matter of trying to tell more of the story rather than trying to tell a different story.
Mm.
As I mean, I'd like you, I find a lot of the material here genuinely inspiring with a number of caveats. That's the problem. It works right. Because it is genuinely inspiring to see someone play an instrument that well, jump that that far, and you can really you can see the work they've put into their choice of vocation from their achievement. And certainly, I think that the Yes I Can video is a step forward from a lot of the narrowly physicalist representations. I'm glad that they've included achievement that isn't purely athletic in those videos. I think that's one step towards let's say normalization and more of a nuanced understandings.
Yeah, and I think it's it can help to sort of think about which kinds of elements could make it a little bit better. Not that the goal is to just improve this kind of video, but for example, if we know a little bit about, you know, an individual person and the kinds of things that they've dealt with in their life. Some people are incredibly talented at music and sports and haven't worked at all.
Yeah.
It's just because they are born with talents.
Yeah.
I remember watching the Olympic marathon in Rio and thinking about runners, and I have no connection to them, and I don't know if I'm supposed to be inspired or not if I don't have some sort of story. But the problem is, I think to go back to something that we started with, if you just have this sort of simple symbol where it's not about the individual, it's, oh, they had this obstacle and they overcame it, that's all you need to know. It brings up in my mind other sort of narratives and narrative frameworks that we have for putting these together. And I know you've published a bit on the idea of narrative prosthesis in literary texts in particular. Do you want to say something about that?
I'm glad we arrived at narrative prosthesis, because I think that will help us bring up a lot of these issues into the sort of narrative realm. So very briefly, narrative prosthesis was developed by some American, I want to say cultural theorists, literary theorists, who use it as a way to describe what's going on in a narrative when a character is very clearly explained and signified by means of a single bodily characteristic. I think that's fair to say. So it may be an actual prosthesis, as in Captain Ahab, the one who's chasing the white whale. He stands up on the deck of his ship with his prosthetic leg, and the leg is always clearly visible for everyone else who's aboard the ship. And so it's a reminder to them and a reminder to us as readers of why he's obsessed with the whale, because it bit his leg off some years ago. So the prosthesis is visible, and it represents something that's missing from his character. It represents what he's lost and what he's obsessed with regaining. So narrative prosthesis is a way of explaining characters easily and quickly and simply. And it's all over the Western canon. It's in books, it's in films, it's pretty much everywhere you care to look. And, well, why is this a problem? Possibly because it creates a dual standard for how characters should be and can be represented. It creates a different expectation of realism. If you have a narrative prosthesis, if you have a sort of an easy way to signify a character and to explain a character, then you don't need to say a lot of other things. You escape the demands of realism for that character. Whereas other characters may be more well-rounded, more thoroughly situated in their social milieu, any kinds of other factors might enter into it. But if you have a simple explanation, you can use that to explain that character, and that character tends to be disabled, ethnically other, female, or any number of other minorities, or let's say deficits in the literary tradition. So I think that brings us some way toward explaining why certain of these images might be problematic, because they tell us that this is all you need to know. This is all that's going on with this person.
Exactly. That's the point of having a disabled character in a novel, is the disability. And another piece of it that if I can just add to that would be the way that that character with a disability serves only to advance a non-disabled character's development, for example. It's sort of, you know, you do what you're supposed to do with the disability, you signify that alone, and then the main characters can sort of evolve and move on with their lives.
Yeah.
And I think I just watched last night, I told you I was going to watch Me Before You. Which is just a horrible, horrible movie. I was telling Jan, I must be able to find something good about it, but I really don't think I can. But it's an example of where you have a character in a... I'll take that back. It's not that there's nothing good about it, but it's an example of, you know, a character in a wheelchair. That's all you need to know. To the point where that character is, you know, being in a wheelchair must be so bad that anyone in a wheelchair must want to kill themselves. And in fact, that's what he does. I hope I'm not spoiling it. And he's just a kind of, you know, crutch, to use a term quite, you know, consciously, for the main character to then move on and live her life to the full, and he doesn't want to be a burden on here. So the idea of a narrative prosthesis is, you know, we don't need complexity in these characters. They just serve to be a kind of foil to non-disabled characters who then can, you know, get on with their lives or whatever else needs to happen with the plot.
I mean, they become prosthetic themselves as characters. They are prosthetic to another character's development.
Exactly.
There was an interesting discussion about this some years ago. I mean, there's a film, a Swedish film, Fucking Åmål, Show Me Love in English, which is about coming out as a young lesbian in a small town in Sweden, which was a very good film on many merits, but it also featured a character in a wheelchair. And the director was fairly aggressively questioned by disability activists about why is this character so clearly one-dimensional, a villain whose only function is to underscore that, well, one, the protagonist has no friends, only a girl in a wheelchair, and two, a sort of plot-forwarding function. And the director got quite defensive and pointed out that there is no need for realism in the depiction of this character. This character serves only to highlight certain aspects of the plot. He was quite open about it. So I think that this may be a strategy that a lot of artists are using on a fairly conscious level. They know that this repertoire exists, and so they can develop points from it. Jojo Moyes, the author, using the term loosely, of Me Before You, has defended herself by saying that she has personal experience with disability, as in she knows what she's doing, as if that would make it any better.
Yeah, so we can compare some of these texts to... we could maybe look at some of these other examples that we have. What pops into my head as I'm looking at this slide still is the issue of when you have characters portrayed in film, are they actually people who have the disabilities that they are portraying or not? Are they essentially photoshopped? And so, you know, there are other examples like this television show that just started, Speechless, in the U.S. And, you know, we can sort of look at, you know, are there better examples coming out? And do we want to sort of get behind them? At the same time, you know, you might just kind of go, you know, is it so bad that we have to be happy with, you know, there just being anybody, you know, with some sort of disability, you know, represented at all? Sometimes that can be a positive thing if it's, you know, getting more people exposed in a sense, but it can come at such huge costs of reinforcing all kinds of problematic narratives and stereotypes and so on.
Yeah, so there's always the disjunction between what you're who you're representing and what you are representing them as, because again, with throughout all of literature, there have been characters that we would refer to as having an impairment or as being disabled, but who are represented in very different ways. I mean, Victorian literature, just to pick an example at random, is rife with disabled characters, but they serve primarily narrative functions that are specific to their genre. And so that would put us in the position of saying that visibility in itself is never enough. because simply because of people being people, there will always be people with impairments in stories, and so it's very important how they are represented and what kind of the I can't really escape the sort of the question of realism. Differing standards of realism for different classes of people is one of the main problems here. Mm. And of course, that applies to a lot of other groups besides disabled people. It certainly applies to people with various illnesses. And if you look at a lot of literature, it applies simply to the gender divide. That standards of realism for representing women have, generally speaking, been a lot lower than standards of realism for representing men.
Mm. And I think this is also a point where we can make some connections with other social movements, categories, and so on. What I'm thinking of is an analogy between a photoshopped model or a non-disabled actor portraying a disabled person. What would that look like if we're talking about race in an American context? Is it essentially blackface, right? We've come to a point where that would not be okay, right, to have white people portraying black people. But we still have similar issues. How many African Americans are in mainstream television shows? How many Latino people, how many women, how many queer people are more visible? And I think there are analogies that are interesting to make of, on the one hand, yes, you want there to be more visibility. On the other hand, if they tend to be more stereotypical, then maybe it does more damage than good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Although, I mean, these analogies are interesting to make, but they also bring up some problems of difference, because the blackface issue, let's call it that, is particularly salient because you have a number of African-American and minority actors, generally speaking. There aren't that many disabled actors globally. And taking that point a bit further, and maybe this would be a good time to show the clip from Still Alice. There are certain situations in which you can't actually have an actor whose biography covers the points that are intended to be represented on screen. I mean, would you want to show the clip?
Yeah, sure.
Is that,
yeah, you can do that. And I think it might be interesting to actually go beyond into other, less visible forms of
exactly.
impairment as well. So this is just a trailer from this film, Still Alice. We also have a trailer from The Theory of Everything. And both of these films actually had actors in the lead roles who won Oscars, Academy Awards, portraying impairments that they don't actually have, right? So in Still Alice, we have Julianne Moore portraying a woman who develops Alzheimer's, and in The Theory of Everything, we have Eddie Redmayne portraying Stephen Hawking. So it's interesting to sort of think of those perhaps together. But this is just a trailer of the film Still Alice, for those of you who don't know this film, and then we could see what we want to get at with this.
To the most beautiful and the most intelligent woman I've known in my entire life.
Welcome, Dr. Alice Howland.
Thank you. I hope to convince you that by observing these baby steps
Alice, where the hell were you?
Went for a run.
Well, I hope you enjoyed that, because you completely blew our dinner plans.
Something wrong with me.
What's going on?
Oh boy. He's gonna break up or? No. I have Alzheimer's disease. Early onset.
God.
I can see the words hanging in front of me and I can't reach them, and I don't know who I am, and I don't know what I'm gonna lose next. So stethoscope, millennium hedgehog. I'd like to see you go to college.
You can't use your situation to just get me to do everything that
Why
you
can't
need.
I?
Because that's not fair.
I don't have to be fair. I'm your mother.
I hate this is happening to me.
But we have to keep the important things in our life going.
Merry Christmas.
We have to try, or we're going to go crazy.
This might be the last year that I'm myself.
Please don't say that.
I am not suffering. I am struggling. Struggling to be a part of things. To stay connected to who I once was. So live in the moment, I tell myself. It's really all I can do. Live in the moment.
Okay, so you want to talk a little bit about that film?
Sure, I'd love to hear your thoughts too. it's a emotional kind of film, and it's intended to be. It's intended to kind of pull at your heartstrings, as they say. And I think we're supposed to think that this is a tragic story, and that's. Almost all you need to know, and if we're inspired by it, it's that we find a way to sort of move on in our lives, and the we is the non-impaired audience, right? And the line there where she says live in the moment, to me the film actually undercuts that message, and it seems to me that what it does is it presents the life of somebody living with this kind of condition as always inherently horrible. And I think there are more complex and interesting ways of thinking about impairments where, again, yes, there might be obstacles. What is it that makes it difficult to be somebody living with Alzheimer's? Versus assuming that if you're going to be in that situation, you should want to literally commit suicide. And one of the most provocative scenes in this film, I won't give it all away, but I'll just say that what we see is her, early in the film, she creates a kind of message to her later self saying, I'm assuming that if I get to this point where I can't remember things like my daughter's own name, I should want to kill myself. And so it raises, I think, a lot of similar questions to, like Me Before You, other kinds of stereotypes that say, if you're living with an impairment, it must be horrible. And of course, I think it would be really challenging, to say the very least, to live with Alzheimer's. On the other hand, there have to be ways to adjust your expectations to what you're doing with your life, that just because you're not the same person you were before doesn't mean that there is no value in your life. So, I mean, it points to all kinds of debates about assisted suicide and so on. But I think, to me, that's that the sort of devaluing of life with an impairment is deeply troubling here.
Yeah, it also brings up, so the there's another point about contrasts here, because as is obviously visible from the trailer, the tragedy is magnified by the glory of her life pre the onset of Alzheimer's. I mean, she's living a life which is rarely seen outside of Woody Allen movies from the mid-80s, which creates a kind of problem with the lives of everyone else. I mean, would Alzheimer's be less of a tragedy if her life was already pretty shitty? if not, then why not? I mean, why always the contrast? Mm. There's a need with, I think, both illness and disability to create this kind of extreme disjunction between good life, the life worth living implicitly, and the other life, the life post-accident, post-illness, post-anything, which of course creates a huge problem for people whose illnesses are congenital or that cover mm-hmm. most of their lives.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think with this particular example, it can be juxtaposed with other texts to say not only is it a good and very privileged life, you know, to begin with, and therefore it's tragic because she lost all of that. I think it's a great point to say, what about people who don't come from such a privileged position? But the kind of, again, a sort of more intersectional analysis might bring up questions of gender, for example, and say, you know, why do we lavish praise, give this actress an Academy Award for a story in which a smart professional woman is shown to fall down to complete incoherence. Whereas, contrast it with the theory of everything, for example, Stephen Hawking, even though he is physically impaired, it's not the same. Obviously, he's still living, which is important to say, but at the same time, the arc, the narrative trajectory of the film is not to suggest that this is always inevitably horribly tragic. And the key is that his mental capacity is still functioning. But there's a gender element here where I think it plays differently to audiences. It seems problematic to me that still Alice, it's like it needs to take down the professional woman. And from a feminist perspective, I find that troubling. We don't see a lot of other examples where really accomplished men are reduced to scenes the way that Julianne Moore is in this film, and I won't give it away, but just to suggest that, you know, she's presented as this is a horrible life.
Yeah.
I think there are ways that it's important to point out these intersecting axes. It's not just disability, it's also class, it's privilege. What can you afford to do? It's gender, it's race. And often, you know, these categories are combined, right? It's not, let's compare race to disability, because often people are multiply minoritized, right? There, you might be in a minority ethnicity as well as disabled, right? Just because you are African American doesn't mean that you might not also be homosexual or whatever. So I think it's an example of ways you can try to bring some intersectional analysis as well.
Yeah, well, I'm glad we now finally have intersectionality studies in Norway. It was about time. I think you're absolutely right, and those two films contrast very nicely in that way. It's also interesting to see how these dynamics play out in Avatar, which we mm. also have.
We have a still. We can just
still.
Take,
we have a visual reference
a
for that.
Yeah.
I think it's the most financially successful film of all time or something, so you've probably all seen it. But here we have a male wheelchair user who has his consciousness transferred into the body, well, to put it simply, of another, which is of course an ethnically or even more than that, a species-wise other. And so you get both. You get the male intellect being liberated by being set free in a primitive body.
Mm-hmm.
And this is, as I said, one of the most successful films of all time. Certainly it plays to some sort of audience expectation. There's something going on here that people want to hear, that people want to see.
Mm. And what's fascinating to me about this film is the how it reveals some problems with what might otherwise seem to be sort of liberal or progressive kinds of thinking. Because what you get is a kind of, you're supposed to be on the side of the natives who are being, you know, colonized by the evil empire that wants to mine their planet. And so it seems like that's a good thing, right? We like, it's a way to sort of, you know, try to account for guilt we have for being, if we are in certain privileged positions, the history of colonization and empire and so on. At the same time, you have these fantasies, right? And I think this is something you might want to also address. Fantasies, multiple kinds of fantasies that make this film much more troubling. On the one hand, the fantasy is that a white guy can be a better native than the natives, the sort of white messiah kind of thing. The only way they figure out how to fight back against the evil empire is by having a white guy show them how to be more native than they actually are themselves. So he, of course, rises and becomes, you know, the leader, right? Instead of he's just somebody who doesn't quite get it. There's also the fantasy of, you know, being liberated from the wheelchair.
Yeah.
And so I think this is actually, it can be deeply problematic as well as kind of interesting. What do you make of this as a kind of fantasy of being liberated in this way?
Yeah, I think you're pointing at something very important there. I think we see quite a lot of it in the Paralympic images to try and tie things back together. I think we've spoken for nearly an hour now. But I think that the fantasy element is crucial here. And I think that Stella Young doesn't point it out directly, but she gives us something to work with. That in a lot of the kinds of representations of disability that we've talked about here, it functions as both a form of debility as an enabler of fantasy. And I think that works through the reductionist dynamic that we've talked about. Mm. That it's somehow is meant to distill certain life functions and to block out everyday problems. Your only achievement, your only necessary achievement becomes an athletic achievement or whatever kind of achievement is easily visually represented. Probably Stella Young is addressing this when talking about people admiring her on the street, as if her only job for the day was to appear in front of them on the street. Other than that, she doesn't exist. She's not visible to herself or to anyone else. So it's an escapist fantasy in that sense. A lot of everyday life, everyone has troubles, and those troubles become washed away by this very easily representable achievement, which is of course why we don't see any of the practicalities of the main character in Avatar being in a wheelchair on a spaceship, which I would imagine would be somewhat problematic, to say the least. But I think the element of reductionism here is crucial to understanding the fantasy.
Mm. I don't know how much time we have, or I'd like to at least make sure we get to
some questions from.
Can I do a quote from Munch?
Of course, yeah.
I'd like to. Let's see. We can talk more about these. So this is we talked a lot of examples that we don't particularly like. This is an example that I think has more potential. This is a memoir-ish type of book by Harriet McBride Johnson called Too Late to Die Young, Nearly True Tales from the Life. And I just wanted to throw up a quotation from this as a kind of contrast to some of the images that we've been talking about. Maybe I'll just read this and you can follow along. How is it possible that non-disabled people tend to feel sorry for me? It still takes me by surprise. Peter Singer couldn't imagine a disabled child enjoying a day at the beach, and he's hardly alone. The widespread assumption that disability means suffering feeds a fear of difference and a social order that doesn't know what to do with us if it can't make us fit its idea of normal. When we seek what we need to live good lives as we are, we come against that wall. Why bother, the thinking runs? All they can do is suffer. When non-disabled people start learning about disability, what seems most startling, most difficult to accept, is the possibility of pleasure. And I think that strikes a productive alternative note. I don't know.
It does. And the thing is that I agree with a lot of what Harriet McBride Johnson is saying in that quote. It should also be pointed out that Peter Singer is an interesting point of reference here, because he seems to suffer from a lack of imagination in a number of areas. But he also has his opposite number. If we're thinking about the stereotype about children with Down syndrome being some sort of angels, capable only of, let's say, simple pleasures, with none of the frustration of everyday life. That points to the way that the imagination and fantasies about disabled people tend to be pulled towards one or the other extreme. It's either all pleasure or there's no pleasure. So I completely agree with her, but that's that talks about one side of the equation, where maybe Stella Young talks about the other side, where simply the fact of being on the street should inspire so much joy in a disabled person that they should need no other source of pleasure.
Right. I think that's a fantastic point. Maybe, should we stop there and see if there are
Sure.
questions?
Let's see if anyone wants to ask us anything.
Impairments who can be really bad and not have it as an expression of the impairment, not as a prosthesis, right?
Yeah.
Or as, I mean, I think some of the same problems go for women characters too, right? Sort of to build them as full characters and not as one-dimensional, or as you mentioned, crutches to, so to speak, to other people's development. But also have someone with an impairment where that is not a problem, right? That they're facing problems in their lives that are completely, that have to do with completely other things. And have you seen any examples of any of those? I mean, so far?
Sure. I mean, there's few and far between, but I can think of at least one. The one that springs to mind is from one of J.M. Cutsey's fairly, well, it's not recent, but it's from the last 10 years, I think, Slow Man, where impairment features, but is certainly not used as prosthesis. He sort of very deftly avoids that issue. What would be your...
I'm quite curious about this new show, Speechless. Has anybody seen this? I think it just debuted, like, just the other day or something. I will admit that where I live sort of in a scholarly way is, finding all the problematic stuff and all the texts that are around. And, it's hard. I can't, it's much harder. I mean, I share the hope, and it seems like, I think there are, maybe it's too optimistic to think that something like that Superhumans video can point toward, people creating new shows and films and novels and memoirs where you have more complex characters and people. I mean, I think memoir is one place where I think you can get a lot of complexity, but at the same time, sometimes it's deceptive, and so it's you might read something like this and go, oh, this is great because we get to know more about McBride Johnson's life, and I can think of other memoirs dealing with chronic or terminal illness, for example, that seem better because they are more complicated, and it's not just here's what my illness means. Mm-hmm. At the same time, they can then serve similarly kind of prosthetic functions if, for example, it becomes about, what's the best way to die? What's a good death? And you stand in for, I'm fighting my illness or I'm not, and one is better or you're the other. So it's this move to sort of have things oversimplified that, I think we can hope that we'll get better text soon.
Yeah. There is also the point that if those representations were everywhere, would we notice them?
Mm-hmm. That's the thing.
Yeah.
Because another way of looking at it is characters where disability or impairment isn't really made into an issue, right? They're just characters.
Yeah.
Mm. And as in that Ullevål show,
Kampen for tilværelsen.
Yeah.
Did you see that? It's where you had a little person say a realtor. And
yeah.
It wasn't. I think it was mentioned once. Like there was a bad joke made.
Yeah, I mean it was addressed in pretty much in almost in the same way that that is addressed in Game of Thrones.
Yeah.
So we talked about that. Yeah.
Yeah. So we certainly do have those representations.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What do you want to say? A little bit about Game of Thrones.
Yeah, it's an interesting show, which I sometimes use in my teaching because it contrasts so nicely with Tolkien. That even in the fantasy world, you can have radically different interpretations of how to handle disability, race, gender, and so on. Of course, that show is better on some issues of those issues than others. But it certainly had an interesting approach to disability. It doesn't really escape narrative prosthesis. There's a spoiler alert: a character in season one who's paralyzed from the waist down, and that turns out to be a way to sort of to turn him into a telepathic character later on. The physical deficit has to be balanced out later on by a spiritual or mental superpower, which is disappointing to some of us. But certainly, the fact that they have Peter Dinklage. And an actual person with I actually don't know if he has achondroplasia, but certainly a little person playing a person who is a little person in a medieval environment, as opposed to a Tolkien-esque dwarf, which is usually somebody who's 6 feet tall who's been digitally shrunk, which is something very different.
We didn't mention some of the. We've got some slides of some superheroes as well. This another sort of phenomenon that you've written about of the compensatory, you know, if you have some sort of disability, then you also have this compensating superpower, right?
Yeah.
Which might seem like a positive thing to do, but is actually quite troubling if you.
Yeah, I mean, it's built on the notion of a morally just universe. Which in a sense could be, I mean, and that could be extrapolated towards still Alice. I mean, she must have done something wrong in order to contract Alzheimer's, right?
She was maybe a professional
she had
woman.
She had it too good and was a professional woman, exactly. Yeah.
That I appreciate. Wow, I'm a tough crowd. I've been working a lot with Terry Tempest Williams recently, who has two memoirs. One's called Refuge, and the other is called When Women Were Birds, and they're specifically about her mother's terminal breast cancer. It's interesting to think about figures like Susan Sontag. Actually, don't like the memoir that. Son wrote about her at the end of her life. There's different kinds of, you know, Joan Didion, Year of Magical Thinking. It's what's interesting is that many of these memoirs have been huge bestsellers. And Mark Doty has a book called Dog Years, which is about the illnesses and deaths of both human and non-human partners. So a bunch of these have, both, interesting things, but also some quite problematic things. But again, the question could be, why is it that these things attract our attention? And if they were typical, then they wouldn't be winning all these, selling those copies. Why do we go to watch a film like Avatar instead of? There's more I can give you after.
Okay, well, I think maybe we should just say thanks for coming, everyone.
Thanks, yeah.
Thank you, Mike.
This is good stuff. Okay.